Here's the real deal. We thought today, because we're getting close to the end of summer, school has started, we've passed Labor Day, so a lot of people think that summer is over, but it really doesn't end for maybe like another week, and we thought since we're at the end of summer today, we would take our cameras up to Central Park to the Loeb, Loeb Boathouse? Loeb Lake? Lake Loeb? 72nd Street, it's the Loeb Boathouse, it's the lake in Central Park, and we would watch people renting their rowboats and sailing around and having a good time, and we'd chat with these people, and it would be a lot of fun.
Sounded like a lovely idea.
You know, even as I described it to myself, I'm enjoying it.
I can see it.
And as you know, it's been raining all day. Here in New York City, we've had 97 one-hundredths of one inch of accumulated rain. And I guess now it has finally stopped raining. So as you can understand, Paul and the vast North American viewing audience, quite likely there's not much going on at the lake.
I can understand that.
Yeah. So, in fact, there it is. There's the lake.
That's
and
the lake.
Gosh, I was wrong. It's a beehive of activity. That's a lovely shade of green, that water, is it? You're hoping to boat some radioactive trout.
Somebody's renting a boat.
That's our own Larry, Bud Melman. Larry, can you hear me? You can hear me?
Yes.
What is the weather like up there now?
Beautiful.
Uh-huh.
Nice and cool.
It's what?
Cool.
He's doing his owl imitation. For a minute there, I thought I heard a loon.
It's cool. He says it's cool.
And have you seen any bodies bob to the top yet, Calvert?
Not so far, David. Okay. I'm waiting, though.
Okay. Anybody renting boats? Okay, fine. I say... Anybody renting boats?
No, not too many. Just us little people.
Ever seen a guy coil cable?
No.
Yeah.
Should be interesting.
Huh? What?
Should be interesting.
All right, well, try not to catch cold up there on the lake.
I'll try not to.
Okay, we'll be checking back in with you periodically.
Oh, thank you.
Uh-huh. Let me ask you something, Larry. Are you actually in the Navy?
No, not really. Uh-huh. Damn good in the uniform.
I see. $8,000 for that. Well, Hal, by the way, Hal, if you detect the slightest bit of activity up there on the lake,
let
us know immediately. Is she here yet, Morty?
Not yet.
What?
Was it traffic?
What? Traffic from where?
Very bad traffic.
Yeah, but from coming from where? It's like three blocks away, the hotel,
yeah,
right?
Coming from uptown, yeah.
Coming from uptown. Where uptown?
She came in from Long Island, and she's coming in from the bridge.
I see. Yeah, okay. But she should be here.
She will be here. Yeah.
What time was she supposed to be here?
Supposed to be here at 5 o'clock.
5 o'clock, and it's... Oh, well, man, it's 45 minutes after 5.
She's late.
She is late. Man, it's like a steel trap, this guy. You know? He assessed the situation just like that. He listened to all of the arguments, pro and con, and he summed it up in three words. She's late. Two words. Here we go.
Excuse me, Dave.
Yes, what is it, Hal?
Things seem to be picking up on the lake.
Oh, great. Let's go back up there in Central Park and see what... Okay, here we go. Let's... Wow! Man, all right. It appears to be some sort of regatta.
Yeah.
That's
fabulous.
Just amazing.
Out there.
You just see, that goes to show you just never know
That's
about
right.
life.
It brightened up. Out
exactly.
There.
Yeah. Sure.
Clear it up.
Thanks, Hal. So you know, I'm. Oh, look, she's here. Jesse Evert is here. All right, we'll be right back, folks. Oh, we got us a show. Thank you very much for being here. I understand. Wow, look at the size of that ring, though. Man alive, nice going. That's a beauty. So you're a little late, but I understand traffic is a nightmare.
Well, I came from Long Island, and I was told it would take 50 minutes, and it took 2.5 hours.
50 minutes?
Yes.
The last time it took 50 minutes from Long Island was in 1910.
Well.
Anyway, thank you very much for coming, and I'm sorry. Were you getting mad? Were you getting worried? Do you get nervous like that?
I'm panicking. Yeah. I mean, I don't think I've ever been late for a show.
Well, everything worked out just perfectly. So, now, let's...
I'm glad you think so.
You have some anxiety, some apprehension?
I have some, yes.
Well, how may I help?
Just give me a few seconds.
How you feel now?
Okay, fine.
All right. let's talk about this retirement. Now, this turned out to be a huge deal, didn't it?
Yes, bigger than I thought.
Yeah, bigger than you thought. But I guess when you think about it, it would be impossible for it not to be a huge deal.
Well, I didn't mean it to be. I mean, I'm actually playing a tournament in 3 weeks.
Yeah, so what's going on?
I know, exactly. Well, after Wimbledon, Sports Illustrated called and said they'd like to do a piece on my career. So I said, okay. And I told them that the U.S. Open would be my last U.S. Open. Mm-hmm. And it would be my last, you know, really major tournament. So they sort of, you know, I think that they made a big deal about it because everybody knows that I'm going to be playing in 3 weeks. And if I want to play, you know, in October, November, I will.
Yeah. So how many really big tournaments will you not be playing in?
Okay. Well, big tournaments meaning Grand Slam.
The Grand Slam. Those are, what are those?
Don't you know?
Well, let me see if I do. Maybe I do.
Okay.
U.S. Open.
Right.
Pizza Hut invitation?
No, no.
Okay, all right, I got that one wrong.
No.
The French?
Right.
Wimbledon?
Right.
The Parrot? Australian?
Right.
That's it? That's all?
Good.
Well, there
That's
you
great.
Go. So those are the big ones.
Yeah, those are the big ones.
But you're still going to make vast sums of money in these other tournaments, aren't you? Because
Well, I mean, for a few months, I think, you know, I can still play tennis a little bit now.
What made you decide not to play in the big tournaments then?
Because I've been doing this for so long. I mean, I'm 34 years old. I've been playing tennis since I've been 6 years old. And I just don't want to be intense every single day of my life and do this.
And is that the way you had to be to remain at the top of your game?
Because now the players are so tough. I mean, you have Steffi Graf and you have Monica Seles and Martina's playing great, and you really have to commit yourself 100%.
Yeah.
And I can't do that because I'm not 100% of a great natural athlete. So.
What you say there makes it really even doubly amazing. And also, if you think about the number of young kids who have come and gone, who were sensations and won major tournaments and then just disappeared in the time that you were still dominating the game.
You're not going to see tennis players with a 15, 20-year span as far as a career is concerned anymore.
Yeah.
You know, those days are over. And now, because the competition is a lot tougher now than when I started. You know, I had it easy in the beginning. Now it's, you know, players from all over the world are playing. And so I think that the span will be more like 5 to 8 years.
Yeah. Let me ask you this question, and maybe this is just a dumb question, but on the other hand, you were late.
I'm used to it. I'm used to it.
If you had not excelled at tennis to the extent that you have, would you have played it recreationally? Would that have been your first choice for recreation?
No.
What would it have been? Dirt bikes?
Yeah. Mud wrestling.
No. So that was a dumb question.
No, you know, it's not a dumb question. I don't do a whole lot of other sports,
right.
And I don't even enjoy watching sports on TV. You know, mm-hmm. It's not relaxing to me.
Yeah.
It's amazing that I'm in tennis, and the only reason I am is because my father was a tennis pro, and he taught me how to play.
Yeah. Yeah.
But otherwise, I wouldn't be an athlete. I'd be into, you know, psychology or something like that.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, for fun, would you go play golf, maybe? Fishing?
No,
hunting?
I don't like other sports.
Mm-hmm.
I don't.
Skiing?
I don't mean to get mad at you.
Bowling?
But I don't. No. I like skiing.
Curling? Soccer? Australian rules football?
Wrestling?
Look, well, we're live from Lake Loeb. Did you see that earlier? Let's take a look at the lake, Hal. Look at this. Where? There you go.
Oh.
What is that? He's found something. They're dragging the lake, and he's... Some kind of treasure hunt there. Okay, well, what are we doing? A commercial, and then we'll be right back. I'll ask you one more question about the Sports Illustrated cover story. How many times were you on the cover of that magazine? Have you been on?
I don't know.
Many, like 7, 8, 10, perhaps.
Yeah.
And the article you wrote was first person. It was your own little narrative there. And one of the captions of the pictures, you mentioned that Jimmy Connors may have been one of the reasons you didn't win a certain year at Wimbledon. Is that true? Did I misread that, or?
Oh, that's bringing up a sore subject.
But it was.
Do we want to bring this up?
Well, it was in the magazine. That's why I'm asking you about it. I mean, if it weren't in the magazine, I wouldn't have brought it up, would I?
No. No. Of course not. Sports Illustrated, I think, sometimes getting to be a little bit like National Enquirer with some of these.
Really?
With some of these comments, yeah.
Well,
I mean, you know, I think people like to read not only about achievements, but also, obviously, someone's personal life. And I think the point I was trying to make was that tennis wasn't 100% my whole life, that I did have relationships, and I did get upset on the court if something was not right at, you know, in my personal life. And I think that was what I was talking about with Jimmy.
Yeah.
I think I saw him with another girl up in the stands or something.
Well,
I got a little upset.
That's all. I didn't know. I saw it in the magazine, and I thought, well, I'll ask her.
Thanks.
You know, I could have asked him, but he's not here. Crowds out there. The poor little guy's upset now. So tell me about the night at the White House. When did you was this recently? Spent a night there, actually slept over?
Slept in Abe Lincoln's room.
Wow.
With my husband.
Yeah?
No.
Yeah.
And the ghost of Abe Lincoln.
And what was the invitation, first of all? This is the Bush administration?
Yes. We're invited to... Pam Shriver and I played against the Bush brothers. Jeb and Marvin Bush.
Jeb and Marvin Bush?
Yes, and they beat us.
Now, these are...
Seriously.
Yeah.
They're good players. But
these are the president's brothers?
President's sons.
Oh.
Brothers?
Well, you said the Bush brothers. I didn't realize.
Okay,
I'm sorry.
The president's sons, yeah. Jeb and Marvin. Right. Pam Shriver and I played a tennis match against them. And so we were invited up to play the match and then spend the night up there.
What, was it exciting? Was it like a thrill of a lifetime for you? To stay in the White House.
It was very exciting. Yeah. I mean, do I sound excited? It was exciting at the time. Uh-huh. I mean, I...
Well, to think of Abraham
I was
Lincoln was...
Because Pam and I had just lost. I mean, the big thing was that we had lost the tennis match, and that was major depression.
But you must have tanked it, right?
No, we didn't. No,
sure you did.
No, we played on a very fast court, and they were just too strong for us. But
now, what kind of players are they?
They're
fat guys
players.
Full of beer, right?
I thought so.
Yeah.
I thought so. I was having some time off at the time when I was invited, and I had like 2 or 3 weeks off, and I went up there thinking they can't, you know, this is going to be a piece of cake.
Mm-hmm.
And they were very good. They spent like 3 months getting into shape and training and everything.
Yeah. So now, speaking of keeping in shape and so forth, will your daily routine change at all now that you're not playing the major tournaments?
When I said before that I don't like sports, I still work out because I don't really, in the past I haven't wanted to practice for 5 hours, so I try to supplement it with running and bicycling and weights and stuff like that. And the last time I went bicycling, Andy and I were going, we were on some mountain bikes, and we were going through the guard gate at the polo club where we live, and a car went through, and I was right behind the car, and that barrier thing that comes up and down,
right.
That started coming down, and I panicked.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't stop, so I just reached out, and I broke the whole thing in half.
Wow.
And this big wood thing, you know, and then I sort of crashed on it.
Powerful, though.
So I haven't had much success with other training techniques.
And but you live also in Colorado, and are you gonna do any skiing at all?
Yeah, I learned to ski 3 years ago, and I'm pathetic.
That's what your husband is. He's an Olympic skier, right?
Yes.
What Olympics?
That's good. 76 and 81.
Now, what's funny about that?
I don't know. You made it sound like it was like 28 or 1928.
Well, no, I don't know.
Jean-Claude Keeley or something.
This whole thing is going pretty well, hasn't it?
I'm just starting to relax now.
Oh, well, you want to hang around? In the worst way, she wants to hang around. But no, if you want to hang around... Feel free to hang around.
Okay, thank you.
I may leave, but you're more than welcome to hang around. Well, what? Well, anyway, congratulations, and nice seeing you, and thank you for coming by. Mr. Evert, we'll be back. Mm-hmm.